time would fail me to tell you about my journey of faith. Most of you have already known it, you've read it, you've seen it on DVD. I just want to perhaps encapsulate a few elements from it. I heard Marcus talk about how the people in New England viewed Catholics, and I could identify with so much what he was saying. I didn't live in New England, I lived in Michigan, so came from England to Massachusetts to Michigan. This misinformation, and he was so correct in saying that we're looking for Waldo. I like that illustration. Can I use that, Marcus, in my talks from now on? Looking for Waldo and preconditions, presuppositions, I'm trying to say, and that I was raised in a church that was anti-Catholic. I was a Pentecostal, and of course, every Sunday night, or once a Sunday night a month, we had preachers that came to tell us about those heretical Catholics who were the spawn of Satan, who were the corrupt, who were superstitious, who were bead-rubbing, fish-smelling Catholics. Very much like Nazareth. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Can any good thing come out of the Catholic Church? No, not at all. The beast, the Antichrist, coming up out of, slithering up out of the pit, infecting mankind with its venom, killing and persecuting the saints of God. All of that I can identify with. I was raised on that. And he was so correct in saying that we felt that way because we didn't know any better. You see, prejudice is taught. It's not passed through the genes. It's taught. And we were taught some very unnice things about Catholics. In my later life, as I matured in the faith, I lost that edge of bitterness. And I just began to look at Catholics, those poor people. I felt sorry for them. I didn't hate them. I didn't see them as my equal in Christ. My God, they weren't even Christians. But I felt sorry for them because they were in this bondage of superstition and all of these rituals and formalities and speaking in some unknown tongue. Dominoes, my father plays better dominoes than your father. it didn't make sense, you know, the standing, the sitting, the kneeling, the genuflecting, and the hand signals to God and all this good stuff. I just felt sorry for Catholics. But you know, through grace, and this is what Marcus was so good in pointing out, through grace, grace comes before revelation. I'd read a lot of things I'd known before, but once I read them again with grace working in my heart, I saw a whole new light. I had read the Bible for 40 years. I'd read books about the Bible. I'd studied the Bible. I'd diagrammed the books of the Bible. And I thought I had a pretty good grasp on this God thing. So I thought I knew it pretty good. And when I began to read the church fathers, grace moved in my heart and my life. Our Lord said, without me, you can do nothing. And it's by his grace that we are drawn to him. How blessed is the man whom the Lord causes to approach his courts. And so I like to think of it like this. In 1958, I found Jesus. In 1998, I found his church. And it was by grace. 54 of my members came with me into the church after a long journey, a journey filled with pain and with sorrow and with loss, with sacrifice. 54 people came into the church with me, including 14 members of my own family. And people come to me and say, how did you do that? How did you get so many people to follow you? I can't bring one in. And I tell them, it wasn't me, it was grace. And I like the way Paul put it in his letter to the Ephesians, chapter number 2, verse number 8. He says, now by grace you are saved. By grace you are saved. By grace you are saved. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. So I'm here because God has called me here. I'm here because of his grace. And I'm filled with joy. I'm filled with love. I'm filled with hope. Because God is moving upon my life. And I can tell you now, at this very moment, I am where God wants me to be. Can you say that? Yes. At this very moment, I know I'm where God wants me to be. Because God is up to something. Let me pick up the story. Most of you have heard my story. For those of you who have not heard my story, outside the door is a book here. When I came into the church, I had no idea why I was here. I had lost everything, my friends, my family, except for my wife, my kids, and my grandkids, and a few cousins and my sister. Everyone else was gone. No communication. People said, do they call and talk to you? No. Did they come and see you? No. Do they dialogue with you? No. It's over. Gone. Fini. It's over. And I had lost so much. My ministry was buried. I was a pastor, had been a pastor for 25 years, enjoyed being a pastor. Oh, sometime I got a little, I don't know about Marcus, but sometime I got a little hairy there. But most of the time I enjoyed because I recognized that I was in persona Christi. I was in the place of Jesus Christ for my people. I understood that concept, and I wanted to be Jesus to them in a sense that I wanted to convey his love, his concern, his care to them. But here I am now in the Catholic Church with nothing, no job. My wife said, how are we going to eat? I said, I don't know. Said, Alex, how are we going to pay bills? I said, I don't know. It's bad to tell your wife you don't know. All I knew was I had uncovered the greatest treasure in the world. And I had sold everything I had for that one treasure. And somehow that treasure or that treasure keeper was going to make a way out of no way. Have you ever heard of that phrase? He makes a way out of no way. Somehow I just knew that I knew that I knew that he would. How? I had no idea. I think we call that walking by faith. Is that correct? We walk by faith and not by sight. I didn't have a clue how I was going to make it. And so I would go to the monastery every morning, except on the weekends, and I would pray with the cloistered nuns. Liturgy of the Hours would pray, enjoyed that very much. Stay for Mass, very small, maybe 20 people. I love a Mass with a small crowd. It's the propinquity of brothers and sisters together in the presence of Jesus is so special and so sacred. I loved it. And then after Mass, I would stay and I'd talk to the Lord. Have you ever talked to the Lord like you talk to your friends? Have you ever talked to him just, forget all of that. Oh, thou great and lofty one who inhabits eternity, who lives forever, and all the angelic beings, even those with eyes before and behind, say, holy, holy. Just forget that. Have you ever talked to him and say, look, Lord, I have a problem here, and I need some direction. I need you to give me what to do. Why am I here in this church? Why have I come so late in life? I was 60. Marcus, it's all downhill from 55. Here I am 60 with no ministry. And like the unjust steward, I'm too old to dig. And I'm ashamed to beg, what can I do? Lord, why am I here? And I did that for weeks as I'd go and I'd pray. And I did learn a very powerful spirituality that Catholics have, which we call contemplative prayer. When you pray out of words, and you have no more words you can say, and you're just there with the Lord. And you open your heart and your mind to Him and say, Lord, here I am. There you are. What do you want me to do? You know what the Lord said? Nothing. Nada. Nil. Nothing. Zip. No feeling, no goosebumps, no voices, nothing. I said, Lord, you're not going to talk to me? It was then I found out that God is a good listener. Sometimes we need people to listen to us. We don't necessarily want them to give us advice. We just want to just to hear us pour out of our hearts and souls what's really bugging us. And I guess God said, I'm going to be a good listener. And then after I listen, I'm going to show you why you're here. So I had no inkling why I'm here. And then people begin to call me and say, would you come and share with us your testimony? Calls from around the country, calls from Africa, calls from the Caribbean nations, calls to come from Alaska, Canada. Good Lord. I said, Lord, is this a new ministry that you're opening up to? And I found that it is. But you know the difference? This is His ministry, not mine. Before it was mine, I had my vision, I knew where I wanted to go, I had it planned out, you write it out, and you give your steps how you're going to get there. That was my vision. And I said, without a vision, the people perish, so let me get my vision together and put it together with this mission statement. And that was buried in the year 2000. Now, it's wherever the Lord tells me to go, I go there and I say what He wants me to say. Sometimes I prepare some really nice stuff. I don't even look at it. So why am I here? And I'm going to try to tell this to you in 10, 15 minutes. Because I know you're tired. And I know I've told you so many times before, that old Pentecostal preacher that preached with his eyes closed at night, opened his eyes, custodian, and say, cut out the lights when you're through. So let me move on. The question is asked, is there a word from the Lord? What is God doing today? Never mind what the newspapers and the media says about us. Never mind what you hear contemporary people say about us. The church is fine. It has encountered difficulty all through its history. It has been in crisis for 2,000 years. Man, we don't get moving till crisis get hot. Amen? Do you know when the church really began to grow was when persecutions came? The more they killed them, the more they gave birth to other Christians. So let's just forget the crisis thing. We've always been in trouble with the world. The world has never liked us, never will like us, because we are like Jesus. And He said, if it's hated me, it's going to hate you, because you are part of me. I'm in you and you in me. So let's just accept the fact that there's an element in our society that just doesn't like us. But also know this, it's not just us. There's an element that doesn't like Christians at all, even our separated brothers. And they are under attack, but they're just not as viciously as we are. Because when you want to kill something, you go after the real thing, not its shadow. Amen? I'm sorry, I just put that in there. Why am I here? Why are you here? You're here because the Spirit of God is moving upon your heart. This message is to inspire you, not to inform you, because the Holy Spirit is already at work in your life. Or maybe you wouldn't be here. He wants you to know that you are here for a purpose and that he is at work in our day. From what I can read from church documents, what I can hear in the church teachings, in the Holy Father's teachings, what I can feel in my very soul that's taking place, is God is at work renewing the face of the earth. Don't you believe the propaganda that the church is falling apart, that our society is lost? The Holy Spirit is at work in his people, renewing the face of the earth. And guess what? Read the book of Revelation. We win. Vatican II was a turning point for our church. The Holy Spirit called Vatican II through Pope John the 23rd. May I briefly say this? Four things that came out of Vatican II. Number one, the call to dialogue with modern society. Don't back away from it, but dialogue with it. Don't just enclose ourselves in our beautiful churches and cathedrals, but engage modern society. Engage modern society, because we got a message that works. We serve a living God, not a dead concept, not a principle, but a living God that lives in us, that has a goal, a purpose. We have a goal and a purpose, and that goal and purpose that comes from our Heavenly Father is to renew the face of the earth. And so the church said, let's engage modern man. Let's not destroy it. Let's not just damn it, but let's engage and share what we got, because what we got can heal the nation's woes. Amen. St. Paul said in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation. The gospel that we have, the very life that we have, the life of the Trinity that flows in our hearts and our souls, can transform the face of our culture, transform the face of our society. For St. Paul tells us, greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world. We have the champion on our side, and the champion is Jesus Christ. And not only Jesus Christ, but his Father. And not only his Father, but his mother, and not only his mother, but the saints that have gone before us, and not only the saints that have gone before us, but the myriads and myriads of angels that serve our God. We are in the majority, and we are going to win this battle. Amen. Yeah. I'm so sick and tired hearing people say, oh Lord, what we gonna do? Oh Lord, what we gonna do? Time sure is bad. Oh, but where sin is, grace abounds much more. Hallelujah. I don't mean to preach to y'all tonight. So, number one, the call to dialogue with the world. Number two, the call to holiness. We've all been called to be holy. I like what St. Peter says in his epistle. It says, as he that hath called you is holy, be holy. That's not just for the clergy. That's not just for the religious. It's for all of us. We all are called to be holy because we are holy. And we are holy not by virtue of what we do, but by virtue of who we are. We, John says, now are the sons of God, the children of God. Now we are his children. We share in his genetic makeup. We share in his character. We share in his image. We are the children of God. We share in his holiness. You ever listen to those Eucharistic prayers that the priest prays? Well, since I'm a deacon, I'm standing right behind him. I just want to hug him when he prays him. When it gets to the epiclesis, he puts his hand and said, for all life and all holiness comes from you. Now let your spirit. Yes. Our holiness comes from Jesus Christ. It comes through our baptism. When we are baptized, we are born again. None of this stuff about going over to the first assembly and getting born again. That's not true. When you're born again, you're baptized into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. That is your new birth. You may have a conversion somewhere else, but you are born again through your baptism. Amen?
Amen.
So, by virtue of your baptism, you are called to many things. You're called to the holiness of God. You are called to live a holy life. You are called to share in the apostolate of Jesus Christ, who was prophet, priest, and king. You are called to share in that. Much I'll talk about that a little later. Third call, a call to empower the laity. The church needs you. You are the church. God needs you. Just touch a neighbor on the shoulder and say, neighbor, God needs you. Touch your neighbor on the shoulder and say, neighbor, God needs you. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. If we say that the extraordinary magisterium is the council, then the Holy Spirit is moving in the council and has moved in the council and has said to the laity, now I empower you, not only with gifts, but with a new and fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit, that you can go and renew the face of the earth. He has begun to renew his church through the laity. I see it everywhere I go. My God, my brothers and sisters, what do you think this is? Are you ordained, Marcus? Are you ordained with apostolic ministry? Are you ordained? Are you a deacon, priest, or a bishop? So you're a laity. Need I say more? Empowering laity. And my brothers and sisters, as I go throughout this country and around the world, I see lay people being raised up by the Holy Spirit, men giving gifts and charisms of the Holy Spirit to do the work of renewing not only the church, but the world. So Vatican II calls the laity to renewal. Pope John Paul II, or should I say Saint John Paul II? Maybe I'm being premature, I don't know. He tells us that God calls the laity to minister. Remember some Sundays ago, we had the reading, the gospel reading in Luke's gospel, where Peter was in, Jesus was in Peter's boat. He was out in the water and had fished all night and got nothing. And Jesus said, go out into the deep, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draft. And he did. And he caught so many, his net began to break. He called to John and his brothers and said, come help me. Well, that represents the priesthood. Peter and John and Andrew, his brother, and James, that stands for the hierarchical priesthood, pulling in the fish. But guess what? Their boats began to sink. So what did they do? They turned to the other little boats around and said, come help us, come help us. We are those small boats. We are those boats that they're calling to come help us. Help us bring people into the church. Help us keep them there. Help us to renew the face of the church. This is what God is doing in this 21st century. He wants to renew the face of the earth. He wants to renew his church. He wants to renew you. So he's raising up men and women. God is an equal opportunity employer. And he's putting on their hearts to be renewed. I remember a young lady I met in California. She came to me and she invited me to come to her prayer group and had a breakfast. I went, about 300 people there. Oh, nice prayer group. She said, I started out with me. So I went to my pastor and said, Pastor, I want to start a prayer group. He said, no way. You want to pray? Pray in your home. I said, I didn't get upset, didn't get mad. I went home and prayed. And the Lord said, call your best friend. So I called my best friend, and my best friend came over, and I prayed, and we got set on fire. So we called two more people, and they came until it grew to be over 200 people. And the pastor came back and said, hey, you can bring this back into the church. God is at work, my brothers and sisters. The last call, the call evangelization. Wish I had time to work with that, but I don't have time for that. What is evangelization? Evangelization is a call to the gospel. It's a call that the gospel values be implemented in our society and our culture. It's all about the gospel. It's all about love and a forgiveness. This is what the church means when it says evangelization and the call to evangelization. Call to live the gospel, call to demonstrate the gospel, a call to proclaim the gospel. Guess who's doing it and doing it very well? Are the evangelicals. They're doing it very well. They may not have the fullness of truth, but what they have, they're excited about it. Have you met them on the corner? Have you met them at the bus stop? Have you met them by the water cooler? Have you met them in the neighborhood? And they ask you the question, do you know Jesus? Have you been saved? Have you been born again? If you died tonight, would heaven be your home? And most Catholics answer that wrongly. I don't know. I hope so. I'm trying. But it's that passion. The message may be a little bit off key, but it's that passion, that inflamed heart that compels them to share what they have received from the Lord. Because my brothers and sisters, this is the way it works. We touch God, we experience the resurrected Lord, and that sends us on mission. We cannot keep it to ourselves. We cannot hold it within ourselves once our hearts have been set aflame by the Holy Spirit. Once we have touched the face of God and He has transformed us, we must share that good news with someone else. And so therefore evangelization begins in the church, not in the neighborhood, but in the church, equipping God's people. Ephesians chapter number four, equipping God's saints, equipping them through renewal and through conversion, equipping them with knowledge, teachings, to know what they believe, not to be ashamed of who they are, being able to communicate their faith to those around them. Yes, we can do that. And this is what evangelization begins with. It begins with us, the faithful, in renewal, in reaching out to those within our families, within our parishes that have slacked off and not really participating in church life. Reaching out to them with the hand of love and forgiveness, a hand of concern and care, having the heart of Jesus Christ. That's what our Father wants. He wants us to have the heart, His heart. Like when He saw the prodigal son afar off. Oh, He didn't sit there and think, I've got some real punishments for him. Oh boy, here he comes begging with his hand out. I'm gonna give him the meanest and the dirtiest task. No, he didn't do that at all. He saw his son coming a long way off, and the old man got off of his chair, ran down the porch, down the stairs, down the pathway to his son, and embraced him. My brothers and sisters, this is the heart of God. This is what all of this is about. This is why we're here. We're here so that we can learn and know, and not to be ashamed, to learn how to articulate our faith and then share our faith with those around us in love and charity. This is what God is all about. It's about redemption. It's about sharing the good news. He's touched our lives and made such a great difference. If He's ever lifted you, if He's ever heard your prayer, if He's ever empowered you, if He's ever taken you through a sickness, if He's ever taken you through a crisis in your life, if He's ever brought a loved one back to you, then you've got a story to tell that prayer works, that God cares, that God loves. And He says, I want you to tell somebody. You don't have to be a theologian. You just have to touch our Master and know that His love fills your heart. Though our hearts may burn with the love of Jesus Christ, that we can't keep it to ourselves. We have to tell somebody about this wonderful Jesus, this wonderful church that we have, so filled with saints and faith and martyrs, so filled with the truth, so filled with the sacraments. How can we not tell them about the Blessed Eucharist, the source and summit of our faith? How every time we come and assemble and come to the Lord's table, we come to the banquet table and we partake of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have altar calls at every Mass. You ever think about that? I'd like to close with this illustration. I've used it so many times. Those of you that have heard me before, you've heard this illustration before. Those of you that have not heard it, it is for your benefit that I say this. We are blessed We are more blessed than you'll ever know. God is among us. God is with us. God is in us. And God is for us. There was in the Old Testament a story told of four lepers, found in 2 Kings chapter number 7. If you want to read it tonight in your hotel room, go read it and see if I'm telling you the truth. These four lepers were outside of a city called Samaria in the northern kingdom that was under attack by the Syrians. And the Syrians used starvation as a weapon of war. They surrounded the town and let no one in, no one out, no food could go in. And for weeks and weeks and weeks, that poor city was starving. Pretty soon they began to eat the grass. And after the grass came the animals. And after the animals came the babies and the children. In the meantime, these four lepers who were not allowed inside the city because they were lepers also suffered. They were starving as well. But not only starving, they were afflicted with a dreaded disease. Their clothes were in tatters. Their hair was disheveled. They were in a bad way. They were weakened by the disease, weakened by hunger. And old Hiram, one of them said, you know, the Syrians over there in their tent got some good food cooking. I can smell it from over here. I can smell those ham hock and greens. He said, why don't we walk over there and just throw ourselves on the mercy of the Syrians? One of two things will happen. They will either feed us, have compassion on us, or they will kill us and we'll die instantly. We're going to die anyway. So these four little weak lepers begin to walk over there. Oh, I love this story because God takes our weaknesses and he uses our weaknesses to build his kingdom and to fulfill his purposes. As these weak four lepers were walking towards the Syrian camp, God got into their footsteps and began to amplify the footsteps. And someone heard a rumbling and he said, the Israelites have hired the Hittites against us. Run for your lives. And over 100,000 Syrians, left all of their food cooking, left all of their armament. All of their jewelry and weapons of war, and they ran for their lives. Old Hiram and the rest of his friends walked into the camp. Nobody was there. He walked into the camp's tent, and there on the fire was some greens and neck bones. On the hearth was some cornbread and biscuits. Fried chicken, potato pie. See, that's my culture. Just put your culture there, okay? And those four lepers began to eat and eat and eat, and their little stomachs began to get distended and gets bigger and bigger. And they'd go over to where the Syrians had their jewelry, left their jewelry, and put the rings on their little nubby fingers and take the clothes they had left on the floor and put them around them, parade around in these beautiful robes. And, oh, look at their rings, and they're all happy. Looking at the jewelry, the pendants. And one of them had an idea. He said, you know what? It's not good for us to enjoy all of these things that we have stumbled into. There's a whole city over there that's starving to death. Let's go tell them that there's food over here. So they went to the city and they hollered to the guard on the wall, you can come out now. The Syrians are gone. And their tents are filled with food. And everybody rushed out of that city and went to that tent and found all of the food and they ate and were delivered. My brothers and sisters, there's a whole city living around us that's impoverished by sin and impoverished by darkness, impoverished by lack of spiritual food. And every mass we come, we sit at the banquet table and we share in the body of our Lord. And we hear the word of God proclaimed. And we are so gospel fat that we do not well to keep this goodness to ourselves. But there are people around us, oh, you know them, you see them on your job, you see them where you recreate, you see them in the boardrooms, you see wherever you go, you see them there, good people, but in quiet desperation. Let us tell them to come to the house of the Lord, the table of the Lord, where the feast of the Lord has gone on, where they can be forgiven of their sins and they can be fed the food of God. God bless you and God keep you.